Okay, this week I'm asking you to read a couple of plays by the playwright Euripides. You'll find on the Blackboard site a copy of his play Alcestis and then his play The Bacchae. And before you dive into those, I think it's worth knowing something a little bit about Euripides and his style and some of the themes that were that he often kind of went back to time and again to better help us kind of understand these plays and better interpret them. And so I just want to spend just a few minutes here kind of talking about Euripides and putting him in context, and so you're just much better armed but when you sit down to tackle these plays. So Euripides is along with Sophocles, you can see by their dates here, they belong to kind of the second great generation of Greek tragedy. Euripides is one of the so-called big three, Aeschylus, Sophocles, and Euripides, whose works survive, or at least some of their works survive intact from antiquity. Aeschylus is sometimes referred to as kind of the grandfather of tragedy. He dies really before kind of the decline of Athens, after which really starts to take place, after that devastating plague, and then after this drawn-out war with Sparta, it towards the last third of that century. And Sophocles and Euripides were more or less contemporaries. Sophocles, we think, was probably a little bit older, and they really strikingly died within just a couple months of each other in the year 406 BC BCE. I have kind of these little nicknames off to the side that sometimes people will affix to their names to help us kind of better understand their style and the themes that they would often return to. Aeschylus is sometimes called the traditionalist. I know I didn't ask you to read any plays by Aeschylus, but he's kind of the conservative, you might say, of the group, a firm believer in Athenian democracy, a firm believer in the idea that good government could be helped by the gods, and human beings could partner with the gods for the furtherance of humanity. And so he's deeply rooted in kind of traditional religion, but sees it in large part through a kind of an optimistic le lens, in as much that a someone who writes tragedies can be optimistic. But both Sophocles and Euripides are writing their plays more or less on the other side of this devastating plague, and also during this war with Sparta, this war we call the Peloponnesian War, which just ultimately does not go well for Athens. They end up losing that war just a couple of years after Sophocles and Euripides die. So the Athens that they lived in and wrote for was a much drearier, darker place, much more a much more tragic place. And their plays reflect it. So Sophocles is sometimes called the existentialist, and in that, well, Aeschylus would have said, yes, the gods, if we do the right things, they can be on our side. They can come down from Olympus and partner with us. Sophocles' gods are distant, and they're real, but they're inscrutable, or they make pronouncements, and you can't beseech them with prayers. You can't change their minds. And so they appear in kind of dire oracles, like in the Oedipus play. He tells Oedipus, "Yes, you're the man who will kill his father and marry his mother. That's it. And you can't appeal to the gods." And so the gods kind of hide behind these oracles, and they're inscrutable and they're distant. And that would make sense, of course, for a culture that had just lost a third of its population to a plague. One of the questions they might be asking: where were the gods in all of this? And so the gods recede and they disappear. And Euripides is sometimes taken to, is interpreted taking even a darker look. So he's sometimes called the realist, or even sometimes called the atheist. And not so much in that Euripides didn't believe in the gods, but he, in some ways he's kind of the opposite of Aeschylus, where Aeschylus thought the gods could be on the side of humanity. Euripides sees that the gods are dangerous. And they're dark, and they're self-interested, and they will use humanity for their own ends. And if they are slighted by humanity, they will take deep revenge. That's often the lens through which a play like the Bacchae, the second of the plays I'm asking you to read, is often understood. And so he's a realistic a poeticism. So we don't know a ton about really any of these guys in terms of the biography. We know that Euripides is born somewhere in the kind of the 480s BC, right around the time of kind of the famous Battle of Thermopylae in the 300. And but he lives a long life, probably lived into his 70s, and dies just a few months before Sophocles in 406. So a long life by any standard, but particularly by ancient antiquities standards. And like all of like Aeschylus and Sophocles, very prolific. We know that he wrote over 90 plays during his lifetime. Most of these don't survive. Just like with Aeschylus and Sophocles, we know that they too wrote dozens and dozens of plays, but only a handful survive. But what we do know is that in the Dionysia, this festival in which the playwrights went head to head and they competed with each other, Euripides did not have the success that Aeschylus and Sophocles did. Sophocles was kind of the favorite. He was kind of the one of the three who was really kind of a rock star in his own lifetime. Won 18 first prizes at the Dionysia, like 18 gold medals. Aeschylus won 13 in the generation before. And Euripides, while he competed time and time again, only won four times. And one of those times, as we'll see, was after he was dead. One, his last play, the Bacchae, which I'm asking you to read, was staged after he was dead and won first prize. So he was only around to enjoy three of these victories. And so the tradition about Euripides is that he's kind of the guy that the Greeks love to hate. And when you put these very realist, these very dark plays on stage, it went against the sensibilities of the Athenian audience. There's a lot that we don't know, but the idea seems to be that the Athenian audiences were fairly conservative in their tastes. They expected tragedies to unfold with a certain pattern. The chorus sings here, and then you have a scene of dialogue. They expected certain kinds of themes and certain types of characters to populate their plays. And Euripides seems to have been someone who maybe even took delight in upending those expectations. And he paid for it in terms of kind of his notch count, his victories. So he became kind of the playwright that the populace loved to hate. And the tradition about Euripides is that he kind of reveled in that. He kind of enjoyed playing that kind of spoiler. But we don't know how much of that is kind of folklore after the fact, and how much that is really part of the compared to Sophocles and Aeschylus. Euripides, in some ways, gets the last laugh. 17 or 18 of his plays survive. There's a couple that scholars debate may not be by him, but 18 of his 90 plays that he wrote survive, whereas for Aeschylus and Sophocles, only seven each. So we have a much better kind of a fuller picture of who Euripides was. So I'm asking you to read this one, Alcestis and Bacchae. But we have a much more rounded sense of kind of who Euripides was, because we have so much of much more of his work. And one of the things that we notice about his plays is that he was kind of all over the map in terms of his themes. Plays like the Medea and the Bacchae are kind of straight up, dark, classic, tragic works. Whereas plays like Alcestis and these plays like Iphigenia ad Aulis and Iphigenia ad Tauris, they are sometimes described as being tragicomedies. They kind of mix comic and tragic elements. Plays that are kind of about embracing life but also facing death. The plays that mix kind of dark humor with dark tragedy. And it's that kind of thing that really seems to have confused his audiences and may have been one of the things that put them off and prevented them from ultimately, awarding him those first prizes. So the tradition about him, he survives as kind of an intellectual iconoclast. That is, he's constantly kind of going against the grain, upending expectations, and kind of not playing by the rules, as it were. Yes, like I said, he's a poet of realism. He's sometimes described as kind of as a kind of psychological poet, playwright. He's interested much more, whereas Sophocles might he's interested in like Oedipus being kind of a plaything of the gods, you might say. Euripides is kind of interested in what makes human beings tick. What's their psychology? Why do they make the choices that they make? Where does their anger, their rage, their good fortune, their bad fortune come from? And he locates it much more in kind of human choices and in human motivations than he does kind of appeal to the gods in that case. Well, you see for yourself if that plays out in the plays that I'm asking you to read, but that's something that critics have noticed, noted and commented upon. There's a famous quote from Aristotle. Aristotle, the great polymath, the philosopher, writer, thinker, who is in kind of had his heyday a good generation or two after the death of Euripides. Aristotle is very interested in tragedy, kind of understanding, why, what made tragedy such a powerful work of art, and what did audiences get out of it, and what makes a good tragedy, what makes a bad tragedy. And so he has this famous line that Sophocles presented men as they ought to be, is that like with Oedipus, that Oedipus, even doomed, he still finds a way to save his city. And so there, even the most cursed of men can be heroes, the idea in Sophocles' book, whereas Euripides presented men as they really are. And so as Sophocles was still kind of holding up an ideal, even as dark as it could be, holding up an ideal for human beings to aspire to, Euripides kind of held up a mirror to society and said, basically, to the Athenians, saying, "This is you." And people struggle with that. People don't often, Euripides kind of, held up a mirror and showed things to the Athenian culture that they didn't want to see. And it disturbed them. And so maybe that's what Aristotle is getting at, this quote here. One of the things that is notable about Euripides is that he populated his plays with women, female characters. And of course, I mean, given the style of theater of the day, they would have all been played by male actors. Even some of that goes on even into Shakespeare's own day, right? But to have put female characters at the center of the play was something that Aeschylus and Sophocles tended not to do, or did much more fewer times. And so plays that center around Medea, actually played by the great Maria Callas, the Greek actress over here, the wild sorceress, Alcestis, who we'll see, Phaedra, Hecuba, Electra, Iphigenia in two plays. And this too, again, seems to have kind of gone against the grain of what people expected in their tragedies, which would have been focused on masculine heroes, tragic heroes. Aeschylus or Euripides upended that with all these female characters. And so he's often, Euripides is often thought to be kind of way ahead of his time. He, in many ways, his plays read and stage much more modernly than Sophocles and Aeschylus' plays do. And so I think a lot of people more, today get a lot more out of Euripides' plays because he's way ahead of the curve in terms of exploring kind of these corners of the culture that were in kind of in the high classical era of Athens, kind of off the table. And one of those being putting women at the center of that culture. But at root, one of the things that he comes back to time again, the focus of psychology of human beings. How do human beings behave when they are pushed to the absolute edge? And so often his characters are kind of teetering on the edge of madness, pushed to their absolute limit. What can a human being go through until he or she snaps? And what does that look like? And so that's something you see. The Medea is very much a play like that. You'll see it in the Bacchae, and you'll see it in the Alcestis as well. So like I said, ahead of his time, he was an innovator. So he played with plot elements, character elements, to a degree, to kind of a conservative audience that expected tragedy to look and sound and perform in a certain kind of way. Maybe put off his audience. And maybe even someone who delighted in subverting that tradition. There are stories about him, and again, we don't really know, is that he loved to experiment with the visual nature of tragedy, and incorporating new scene decoration, sound effects, lighting effects, changing the music to which the choral odes were sung. Again, the kind of thing that for an audience that expected a play to sound a particular way would have been difficult for him. But he was an innovator. And only seems to have been appreciated kind of long after his death. Over here, I just show you that I like this publisher. This is the same publisher who did our Odyssey, Hackett, and they always do these interesting things on their classical text. They will find a modern photograph that seems to kind of correlate to the ancient story. So if you remember the Odyssey, the cover is that famous photograph of the Earth from the Moon. From the Apollo 11 astronauts. And so it's kind of the ultimate journey, the ultimate odyssey from Earth to Moon. Here, the Bacchae a play which I'm asking you to read. I ask you to read my own translation, not the Hackett translation. They put a co on the cover Elvis Presley, the great pop star of the 1950s and 60s, the so-called king of rock and roll. And it's a really wonderful chosen photograph. This is a picture of when he was inducted into the army as a young man. And if you know anything about the story of Elvis, is that when he started to perform, wherever he showed up, these teenage and preteen girls would just actually, go into absolute paroxysms of ecstasy, screaming and crying and weeping as he swiveled his hips on the stage. And of course, it terrified the parents everywhere. Who is this dark, darkly handsome stranger coming to town and leading their women astray? That's very much what Dionysus does in this play. He's the strange, beautiful god who shows up in the city of Thebes. And when Dionysus shows up in your town, all the women go mad in his presence, and that causes a lots of problem for the men left behind. And so I love this kind of that using Elvis Presley as kind of a modern Dionysus who comes to town and turns culture on its head. Another thing that Euripides is known for, and it's something that Aristotle, even way back in the day, criticized him for, was his use of what they called the Deus ex machina, which is a Latin term, literally means God from the machine. And we know that towards the end of kind of the high point of Greek tragedy, that part of the stage apparatus was a large crane that stuck up kind of above the stage and above the actors below. And it was one of the special effects. And so say if you had a play in which you wanted to swing in a divine character or some kind of sublime figure descending from the heavens, you could use this kind of pulley and crane system to lower that figure, either an actor in a harness, or a statue symbolizing a god or goddess, onto the orchestra, onto the stage, as a special effect. And Euripides was famous for kind of employing this in a way that Aristotle thought was kind of a cop-out. And so kind of the idea was is that he would put on these plays that were so wild and chaotic in terms of their plot. By the time you get to the end, there's way too many loose ends to tie up. So what Euripides would do was then which he would just kind of bring in a god, lower a god into the stage, and basically saying this play's over because I'm a god, because I'm a goddess. I have it. The power of Olympus says that this story is over, and so that you'll still see that term in kind of film or theater criticism. It's almost always an unflattering critique. It's kind of, like I said, it's kind of a cop out. And so it's kind of an unbelievable element in a story that is just brought in to kind of wrap up a crazy plot. And so Euripides was famous for doing this kind of thing. Kind of reminds me of the end of the Odyssey, if you remember. Is that you remember at the end of the Odyssey, the Ithacans and Odysseus and his crew are ready to gear up for round two of this civil war, and Athena comes down and says, "Ithacans, stop." And the story is basically over because Athena is a goddess, and she says that it's stopped. It's a very much kind of a god, coming in from the machine to wrap up the story. So, yeah, he was not appreciated in his own lifetime. Like I said, the tradition is that Euripides was the guy that the Athenians loved to hate. You can even see this in these death myths about them, which almost assuredly don't reflect the truth. At all. It's more about kind of the myth reflects what the people felt, how they felt about these characters. Sophocles' death story is that as an old man, 90-year-old man, they brought him out during the Dionysia, and they asked him, would you perform your play, The Antigone, which was the favorite of the Athenians. They thought that was his masterpiece. And Sophocles obliges as a very old man, and he goes out there as a 90-year-old man and performs the whole play front to back. Sings all the parts, does all the dialogue, sings all the choral odes, and with his last breath, he utters the last syllable of the play, and he collapses dead on the stage. And so this idea that he dies at the height of his glory, performing solo style, the play that he was most beloved for. Now, did that happen? Almost assuredly not. In fact, there's another tradition that said he died by choking on a grape, which is probably closer to the truth. Euripides, what we do know, that towards the end of his life, he got so fed up with his reception at Athens that he He went up into self-exile, up into the north, up in Macedonia, where in the next century Alexander the Great will come from, and then change antiquity, change the world forever. But he was lured away by the Macedonians and say, "Hey, if they're not appreciated down there, come on up here, write for us." And he doesn't live up there for long, but he dies up there. And the story was that he was torn apart by wild dogs as he was walking on the paths outside of the Macedonian city centers. Now, did it happen? Who knows? But it's thought that the Bacchae, this play that you read, involves kind of the dismemberment of a human being, and so it's thought that Euripides kind of suffers the demise of one of his own characters. So almost assuredly, just a fictional story, but might reflect kind of the antipathy that the Athenians had for him. So he dies up there in 406 BC, up in Macedonia, and the story goes is that his son, who was also named Euripides, Euripides Jr., goes up there and he settles his father's estate, and he finds amongst his effects this last unpublished, unstaged play, the Bacchae. So he brings it back to Athens, where it is staged at the next Dionysia, and it's almost like this apology to Euripides. And it's seen to be this was his masterpiece. This was his greatest play of all time, which is an opinion that I tend to agree with. It's one of the reasons I'm asking you to read it. I think it is a remarkable work of art, dangerous, daring, awful, tragic, disturbing. And he wins first prize, and that's the first prize that, of course, he's not around to enjoy. All right, so hopefully that gives you a little bit of sense of kind of who this guy was, gives you a little bit of a sense of kind of what kinds of things to expect in these two plays. Read them carefully, respond to the forum questions thoughtfully, and yeah, hopefully I'll see you soon.